Okay. The meeting will come to order. Michael would lead us with a pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
See? You know how I feel. Thank you. And we'll move on to our roll call. Begin with Marion.
Yes, thank you. Mr. Larson? Mr. Abadi?
Here.
Mr. Anderson?
Here.
Mr. McFadden? Mr. Nunez?
Here.
Mr. Perez? Mr. Zendejas?
Here.
Ms. Thomas? Ms. Gomez?
Here.
And we also have here in the audience Mr. Escalera, Mr. Antonio Ortega, Mr. Stills, Mr. Jeff Garber, Ms. Gloria Rivera, Ms. Jennifer Goodsell, and Director Jean-Pierre Menville.
Okay, continuing the roll call, Mr. Blum.
Here.
Mr. Osborne.
Here.
Mr. McNicky.
Present.
Mr. Ramirez.
Present.
Ms. Kay.
Here.
Ms. Ramos Watson.
Present.
Ms. Broughton.
Present.
Ms. Soleil.
Present.
Mr. Bayard.
First present.
Mr. Gibson is not here tonight. In the audience, we have Angela Evans from staff, as well as Pat Swarthout.
Thank you. Each of you should have a packet of our minutes that was mailed to you. So please let me know if there are any errors or corrections.
Move for approval.
Okay.
Second.
All right. Those in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed, say no. The minutes stand passed. Okay, moving on to the next order of business is the public comment period. This is a public meeting, and this is a time for public comment. At this time, you may be heard on any item not listed on the agenda. Those who wish to address the committee should come to the microphone and state your name and address an address for the record. The chair reserves the right to limit the speaker's time, and we request that you limit your remarks to no more than 5 minutes. The comment period will be limited to 10 minutes. Please note the committee may make a recommendation on any item on the agenda. I understand there's someone in La Quinta area that would like to.
Yes, there is.
All right. Please step forward.
That's me. Good evening, ECAC. My name is Mark Weber. I'm the manager of the Coachella Valley Enterprise Zone and a proud resident of La Quinta. And I'm in the first present also. Is that right, Mr. Bayard? First presence? I'm here just to request that I can come back at some point and get on the agenda and make a presentation regarding the Coachella Valley Enterprise Zone. I was in attendance at the ID Board of Directors meeting last week. So hello, everyone down there in El Centro, and President Menville. I appreciate the time to speak at the agenda item that was on the agenda down there at the ID Board. And that agenda item was intended to spur dialogue and conversation about a partnership that I would like to work on with ID staff to do some more economic development activities, possibly entertain revising the somewhat old IED rate for an economic attraction rate, as well as try to find other ways to partner with the Coachella Valley Enterprise Zone, especially since our territory very closely mimics the IED service area up here. The Coachella Valley Enterprise Zone has been around for 20 plus years now, and we've got another 9 years or so of our life. And the whole intent behind the Coachella Valley Enterprise Zone is similar to IED. It's a public service. It's intended to help the community and help expand and help develop some areas, and specifically our mission, underserved areas, which again include much of the IED service territory here in the Coachella Valley. So just to remind everyone, the service territory is Thousand Palms. The unincorporated areas of Riverside County, which include Thousand Palms, Bermuda Dunes, Thermal, Mecca, and then also the incorporated cities, portions of the incorporated cities of Coachella and Indio. And we've got a close relationship with the city of La Quinta as well, because they see the benefits, the ancillary benefits of the Enterprise Zone. So I guess humbly requesting that I can come back and actually make a full presentation. I do want to stress that it's, I think, of great importance for us to have a partnership. IED board is a direct partner with the two Enterprise Zones down in Imperial County, one in Calexico and one in Brawley. And while IED was involved with the Coachella Valley Enterprise Zone on a one-time marketing activity several years ago, I feel it's imperative that the IED and the Coachella Valley Enterprise Zone have a somewhat formalized partnership so we can find out work together to help these underserved areas. And that's the extent of my comments, unless I have any questions or anything.
Thank you.
I for one would like to, since something that you're proposing now, Mr. Weber, would be that maybe the right thing to do to initiate something like that would be to ask the two members from this board, maybe two from Imperial, collectively on what can be done. From my understanding, I do know that the life of the enterprise has been increased once already, and the opportunity for future growth is as far as the life of the Enterprise Zone. So I think it would behoove us to work with Imperial, maybe ask somebody from the executive board, maybe one member and two members of Imperial, two members from us to work on this, because I do see it as an important tool working together. I know what we've done with the Enterprise Board, Enterprise Zone Board prior, so I do know the importance, and I'm sure that Imperial probably feels the same way. So if it's something that this board would like to see, and the one in Imperial as well, we'll I think this would be the time to talk about it.
Yeah, I'd be glad to work with you on that. I think the Enterprise Zone is a great economic development tool for our area as well as Imperial Valley. So I think it's a great idea.
I have a question of staff. What was the board's response when the presentation was made at the last board meeting? Did they have any response or direction?
I can answer that. They directed staff to try to initiate a conversation and have some dialogue on it. But it wasn't definitive in any nature.
Is Mr. Kelly in the audience?
President Menville's there, but I think the intent, it sounded like, was to come back and have some dialogue. So I felt like it was appropriate to come to the ECAC to kind of start that process there, working with and then work with staff also to initiate it and kind of move forward.
Okay, Freddie, I think those are all the comments we have in La Quinta. How do you want to proceed?
Do we? There's a recommendation. Can you restate the recommendation, Marion? Is there a recommendation to, from my understanding, develop some subcommittee at this point? What
the members in La Quinta are desirous of exploring the possibility.
Okay. Do we, Marion? Can you Can you restate the recommendation? Are we going to at this point make a motion to establish a subcommittee, or just explore it further? I mean, I understand that what your interests are, but at this point, I'm not sure how we would proceed further with the development of subcommittee of this sort.
Ms. Alley has some comments.
Yeah. Sorry. Would you rather have committee members or staff be in the liaisons with you?
if that question is directed to me.
Yeah.
I guess what I'd prefer to do, as I mentioned at the IID board, is to work with IID staff, and
yes.
But to also have the opportunity to come back as an agendized item and actually do a presentation for the ECAC, and then follow that up possibly with an IID board presentation as well.
Yes, it did seem to me it would be more logical for you to have a couple of staff members working with you.
Yeah, Patrick Swarth, our public affairs officer. The direction from the board at the last board meeting was he directed the general manager, Kevin Kelly, to assign staff to work with Mark. I'm not sure that that's happened yet, but I'd say we can let that happen. And once that process moves forward, if ECAC wants to be involved with whatever that, direction is, we'd be more than happy to, work that way.
We have Mr. Kelly here. Do you wish to address the committee?
I just wanted to the consensus from the IID board was that staff ought to enter into some talks with Mr. Weber about the work of the Enterprise Zone. I expect that to happen in due course, and we can come back to your ECAC with the progress we've made.
So then are you suggesting that we hold off on a committee structure
right.
until we have something from staff?
I think at least until we've had a chance to speak staff to staff, yes.
Okay, so we'll just enter for the record that we have a couple of members in looking to interested in participating, and then we have Member Osborne who would like to make some comments.
So we'll have something on the next agenda regarding the status of this staff meeting?
I think that's doable, yeah. Yeah, so you should plan on hearing back from us in a month.
Mr. Kelly, this is Mr. Ramirez from City Coachella. one of the things that, I do apologize for missing last month's meeting, but I do plan on being a participant, especially I know that Ms. Watson and I, and are you running for re-election? So we have three members of this board that are running for re-election. I think what's important here is that it's something that, regardless, it's important for to see something back, because we do only meet once a month. It's not like we meet twice a month like on our council seats. And it's to me, the lifeline of these, and I think that especially with the economic interests that are involved, especially. Things are changing every day in what's occurring in our cities. I would just hope that it does come up sooner than later. And like I said, we have, the holidays coming up and so on and so forth. And it's just something for me to make sure that this is doable by the end of our next meeting. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Kelly. Anything further?
No, we'll plan on updating you at your November meeting.
November meeting. Thank you. Okay, moving on. Are there any more comments from La Quinta? Any more public
comments? No more comments in La Quinta.
Very well. Okay, moving on to our next order of business is item number 4, legislative update by Mr. Ortega.
Good evening, Chairman Nunez, members of the ECAC. Antonio Ortega, IID Government Affairs. I am before you today for the third time this year with a legislative update. The first time I was here, I presented you with a very broad legislative platform that was in the month of March. At that time, we truly hadn't set aside or prioritize any bills for the district. At a later presentation in the month of June, I did provide you though with a more detailed legislative update, and I went into some bills by actual number and by a position that the IID Board of Directors had taken or would be taking. And I'm here finally with this presentation now, which now has a status update on all measures that have gone before the governor. There were 5 total bills that the IID Board of Directors took a formal position on, and I am here to provide you with just an update on those bills. The governor had until yesterday at midnight to sign or veto all bills that came before him. And there is also some bills that, if not signed or vetoed, then they automatically become statute or become law, but that is rare. So for the most part, any bill that again goes before the governor, makes it through both houses, will receive a signature from him or a veto. So the bills that I'm going to provide you an update with are again the bills that the IID board took a formal position on. Although there were up to 42 bills that the government affairs section was tracking during the legislative session, a lot of those bills did not make it through their policy committees. Some of them were held up either due to policy questions or to concerns regarding appropriations and the sum of money that would be coming from the general fund to run the programs or the proposals. So what we have before you today are five bills, and I'm going to go through them in numerical order. AB 642, this is one that I did not update you on, so this is the only bill out of the five that you have not heard from me before. So if you have any questions on any of these, feel free to ask. But this bill was actually a last minute gotten amend from Assemblymember Calderon from the Los Angeles area. And what this bill would have done is it would have enacted an agricultural cultivation zone for algae, or for the production of algae in and around the Salton Sea. The act would have authorized the Secretary of the Natural Resources Agency to establish this program in the Imperial and the Coachella Valleys. As part of this program, the Secretary would have also provided grants to those institutions, both public and private, that chose to develop such pilot projects in this region. Now, the reason that this bill was not presented to you at the early June ECAC meeting is because this bill was not amended until late that month, and it had approximately 30 days to be heard in policy committee, appropriations committees. So as you can see, it was one of those that happened very quick, and our board did take a position on this bill, and the position was support if amended. And the amendment was because there was, or the bill did not include a provision that would include locals in this framework or this new program. This bill came out of the LA area from an LA member, but they never included none of our local assembly representatives, our senator, nor did they include any of the local government bodies, Riverside County, Imperial County, IID. So it caught everyone off guard. So there were some things in the bill that needed to be amended, and therefore our board took a supportive amended position. Ultimately, the bill died in Appropriations Committee, and that is the status of it. It failed passage. You know, most of the folks, once a bill fails passage, you say it died in committee. So that's what happened to this bill. So it did not move forward. There's really nothing to report at this time. But if another assembly member at a later time decides that this is important enough for them to reintroduce, then that would happen starting the next legislative session. So if there are no questions, I will move on to the next one. The next one was Assembly Bill 939. Which later became Assembly Bill 1410. And it was the identical bill, but because one, the former version of it was held in committee, then members are allowed a procedure where they, again, they can gut all the language or remove all the language from one bill number and put it into another and try to revive it or keep it moving again. And that's what, in fact, Assemblymember Perez, who's our local representative, did. He tried to bring this bill back the last 2 weeks of session. Ultimately, the status of the bill is that it failed passage in the Appropriations Committee. This bill, if you recall from my prior presentation, was the bill that would have brought back or given the local Salton Sea Authority additional powers and responsibilities when it comes to the restoration of the Salton Sea. And that would have been done through partnership and collaboration with California Natural Resources Agency. This was a priority bill for the assembly member, as well as for Imperial County, Riverside County, IID, ourselves here at the local level, but also our lobbyists in Sacramento were very involved with the day-to-day lobbying on this bill. And again, unfortunately, it was held in committee, but Assemblymember Perez has publicly stated that he is going to try again next year, whether it's this exact same bill or a modified version of it. But ultimately, the end game is to keep pushing at having the locals have additional say or authority when it comes to moving the Salton Sea restoration efforts forward. And again, the position was a support by IID. I will move then to the next bill. I'm sorry, there's a question.
Yes, I did have a question. Originally, the Salton Sea Authority was here locally, more or less. Then it got switched to the state level. Now you're trying to switch it back to the local level again. Is that correct?
No, the Salton Sea Authority is the JPA that's comprised of membership mm-hmm. of IID, the Coachella Valley Water District, Imperial County, Riverside County, and the Torres Martinez Tribe. But I think maybe yes. your question is the Salton Sea Restoration Council, which was the body that that was supposed to take over these duties and responsibilities. That was through Senator Duchaney's bill from 2009. And because that actual council never got off the ground, they never met. The Natural Resources Agency seemed to be unwilling to actually get that off the ground. So yes, this bill would have removed or stripped that council's authority, but given it back to the locals with this new framework that AB 939 tried to establish.
Can you tell me why it didn't pass at the state level?
Because it was held in the Appropriations Committee, the
it just never got out. Is that
correct? It was.
It
was held in the. It was held in the suspense file, is what they call it, right? And for those of you that have been through this process or have ever lobbied, it's a dark place that nobody knows what happens to the bills. They just disappear, and they don't get out. But Assemblymember Perez last week was actually at the Salton Sea Authority meeting, and he provided just a bit more insight than what I just told you. And directly from him was that there might have been some confusion at the committee level because of the prior bill that I just spoke about, AB 642. And there was a conflict of the process and what the locals were trying to advocate for, whether it was a pilot project for algae or whether it was a Salton Sea general framework. So because of some of those issues, there were questions that came up about what it is that we really wanted to do down here and how much funding was going to be expended on either grants for algae production or for the feasibility study that the AB 939 called for. So somewhere along all those lines in that gray area is where this bill unfortunately was fell victim of some of that confusion, I believe.
Was it due to a lack of funds? Or funds didn't seem to me to be part of the last bill that you talked about. So the first one having to do with grants had to do with funds.
Yes, well, for AB 939, there was a request for $2 million for a feasibility study that would come from the Salton Sea Restoration Fund. But that money is currently allocated, and it's sitting in that pot. So that is why there is, again, there's a kind of a cloud of confusion as to why this bill was still held in the Appropriations Committee, knowing that there is funding there for these type of purposes, or at least that was the assembly member's argument. So why is it that the bill was held? And that is still a big question mark. And even tomorrow, I don't think I could answer the question. Because again, there was that confusion that was put out there.
But Assemblyman Perez is going to try to do it for next year now, is that right? He's going to try to rework it? Or because this is important for the whole state, really.
Yes, he is. And
confusion should not be the defining factor. You know what I'm saying? Confusion should never be the reason that something doesn't pass, in my opinion. But
yes, and I agree. And again, I can only say what I heard him say there last week,
yes,
which was
yes.
that he is actually currently in dialogue with the Natural Resources Agency, and they're trying to put together some type of a reworked version of this bill that would have buy-in from the agency even before it gets to any of the policy committees, and that way it's very clear since day one that there should be no misrepresentation of where the bill is going and the policy. So if he is able to do that in the fall before they reconvene in January, I think this bill would actually have a better opportunity or a better shot at moving forward next year.
Will it include something about algae, or is that going to be two separate bills always?
Yeah, and that's a great question, because that would have to be posed to the assembly member, given that assembly member Calderon is a different author than assembly member Perez. But because some of the language in AB 642 and the importance of algae production in and around the Salton Sea, there are some positives to moving that forward, or such a program forward. So the assembly member might decide, and that being assembly member Perez, might decide that some of those components can be a part of this bill. But again, that's just my personal opinion. Again, he might not do that, or he may.
Okay. Thank you so much for your report on that.
I think we have one more question here. Member Ramirez, did you have any questions? No? Okay. Any more questions in La Quinta? That's it for La Quinta.
Thank you. Any questions in El Centro?
Okay. The next bill is Assembly Bill 2205. And again, this was reported on back in June. And this is a bill that relates to the extraction of lithium and other materials from a geothermal production site. And essentially what this bill would have done, or actually what it does, because this is one of the few that was signed into law by the governor that we took a position on, is that it codified or made some clarifications to the language that would allow such process to occur. And by doing that, one of our local a company by the name of Symbol Mining actually has operations currently and is looking to do this type of work. This would allow them to do so. So this bill came directly from a local industry who is doing this on the ground today, and by having this additional clarification or language in statute, it just moves them that further along and allows them to keep their operations open and increase their job productions here in Imperial Valley and any other location in California that has geothermal development. So again, this bill did have a support position from the IID Board of Directors, and it was signed by the governor on September 7th. There's a question.
Question, Mr. Abadi.
Mr. Ortega, on this method of this new law and new method of extracting minerals, on this effort, is any of the energy spent on that effort now considered parasitic beneficiary to the area which this new effort is put to?
No, nothing in this bill made any reference to the parasitic load.
But it's different than a generation of power. It's actually, this is now another effort to...
It's more of a byproduct, right?
Yeah, it's a byproduct. So now that effort ought to have some value, I would think, now that we're using green energy to produce this byproduct. So is there any credit on the parasitic load? I know we've been discussing this some time. Was that followed through with this, and how's that discussion?
Well...
Now, Mike, Symbol isn't using green energy. We're actually supplying them from our grid.
What was that, Mr. Stills?
Symbol Energy is not using green energy for the mining extraction process. We're actually supplying them energy from our grid.
So you're flashing flag?
No, Symbol is a separate company. It goes through the flash process and geothermal from the geothermal plant. The geothermal plant is using their own parasitic load. Symbol Mining is a separate company where they just run the brine over to, but we're actually supplying the energy from our grid to that company so they can extract the minerals.
Is it a separate facility or a separate process?
Separate facility, and there is a piping system that pipes the brine over to it.
Okay, if something like this were to exist on the same facility, an additional process, that would be part of a parasitic.
If a geothermal company was doing it and they were supplying it with their parasitic load, then it would be an issue. Since this is a separate company, they're actually in contract with us to supply energy to them.
So they're in the business of going after this mineral rather than producing a renewable.
Correct.
Okay.
Thank you. Any further questions in El Centro? La Quinta, any questions in La Quinta area?
No, we're complete here. Thank you.
Okay. And finally was Senate Bill 1332, which was by Senator Negrete McLeod. And this was a follow-up bill to prior legislation that Senator Negrete McLeod adopted or introduced back in 2010. And what this bill does, it requires that publicly owned utilities adopt a feed-in tariff program by July of 2013. Current law requires all utilities to adopt such a program, but it did not establish a specific deadline for publicly owned utilities, which is what IID falls under. And that's in contrast to an investor-owned utility, which is governed by the Public Utilities Commission. So because of that lack of deadline or time certain date, Senator McLeod felt that she needed to come back and make that clarification. This bill had a support if amended position by our board of directors, and for two reasons. One is that not only did it mandates a January 2013 date, but it also added what we refer to as avoided costs and increasing or subsidizing costs for feed-in tariff contracts. And it was mandating this to a publicly owned utility, which is supposed to be governed by its locally elected board of directors. So for those reasons, we asked Senator McLeod to amend her bill. And although she made some amendments that changed the date from January 1st, 2013 to July 2013, and she also softened or the language wasn't as strong that said require publicly owned utilities to adopt these avoided costs, the bill still didn't get to where I think, or where at least the California Municipal Utilities Association and SCAPA and even IID and the other POUs felt that we would support it. But it also did not prompt us to oppose it because, again, it was current law that already established this program. The only missing component, again, was the time or the deadline that would be given. So that bill actually was signed by the governor just 2 days ago over the weekend. I had already submitted this PowerPoint presentation on Wednesday, so in your list it says awaiting action by governor, but in fact it has been signed into law. So IID currently is working to adopt a feed-in tariff program, and now we just have to meet the July 2013 deadline. So that is the only thing different that this bill is doing. Are there any other questions?
Any questions in El Centro? Mr. Body?
I don't necessarily have a question on any of the state bills, Mr. Ortega, that you've brought, but I thank you very much for your update on that. I had a question a year ago, which I requested some updates on and have yet to receive them. I'd like to know where S-400 is at. And that's a transmission, sharing cost at the federal level, and also at the federal level, the large hydro division of that power. I've asked these questions a year ago, and we're supposed to get updated. We've received nothing at the federal level as far as what's going on. Okay. But I do appreciate your state level update. Okay. Do you have any updates on those two?
I know that, Patrick, maybe you can help me with S-400. I believe that was a carryover from like 2010, maybe?
He's the one I asked a year ago.
Yes, you're correct, Anthony. And I researched that and had the information sent to you, Mr. Abadi, when we were researching it. That bill has died and has not carried on any further. As of, I believe it was September of last year. I'm not sure if it'll be taken up again or maybe even be in the lame duck session that could happen after the election, but we will watch that real close, and if anything turns around, we will be sure and get that information to you.
Mr. Sorthau, could you resend that to me? I don't think I got a copy of that, and the rest of the board members on that S-400, where is that's one you're talking about?
Yes, that's the one I'm talking about. I'd be happy to.
Okay, and then also the large hydro, the division of large hydro.
Yeah. I'm not sure. Was there a bill number attached to that?
It was being discussed. I don't think there's a bill associated with it, but it was a division to be discussed along all the SCAPA members, California share of all large hydro coming out of the Hoover.
If you're talking about the division of that, what they had taken and divided up a bunch of power, and they took a reduction by 5%, and that was to be divided up amongst the three states and the tribal members, I'm not sure where that's at. I do know that that went through, if I'm not mistaken. If that's what you're talking about, I'm not sure that that's the one you're talking about.
Actually, if I might, to respond to Mr. Abadi's question, we had a staff meeting today, and Belen Valenzuela, who's doing resource planning, she's tracking the Hoover repower, and and we will be back to you in a month with that distinction we talked about on large versus small hydro.
Thank you.
I have a question here in looking to Freddie.
Okay, go ahead.
Mr. Blum.
Yes, Frank Blum. Antonio, would you explain, if it doesn't take more than a couple of minutes, we'll do it at another time, what the what a feed-in tariff is and how it operates?
Yes, a feed-in tariff is a predefined contract for small-scale renewable projects or generation where a utility must pay this predefined contract price, or again, this pre-designated price for projects usually in the 1.5 up to 3 megawatt range. So this is, again, small scale, usually solar. LADWP has adopted recently a pilot project where they are going to introduce these renewables into their grid. IID again is going to be doing this, but the difference, and I believe that a question came up the last time I presented, and sometimes it's confused with net energy metering. So what is the difference between the feed-in tariff versus net energy metering? net energy metering, which is what we currently have here at IED and most other publicly owned utilities, is where you can roll back your meter, but up to the amount of energy that you've used. But that's it. Feed-in tariff, on the other hand, allows you to sell back the excess power, not only what you've consumed, but anything that you produce on top of that. So that is, again, the simple nutshell version of what feed-in tariff is versus net energy metering.
Very good. Thank you.
Okay. Any further questions in La Quinta?
Yes.
Yeah, Antonio, Steve Bayard here. This bill, of course, requires publicly owned utilities to do this. How long have privately owned utilities had to do this? You have an idea?
Well, the initial bill that I mentioned where both IOUs and POUs were required to do this was adopted in 2010. Because the privately owned utilities or the IOUs, investor-owned utilities, are governed by the Public Utilities Commission, the commission has been implementing new policies and trying to give them a time certain date, but I'm not aware if that date is before the July deadline. So I would have to get back to you and tell you what the exact time is that they have to comply with this mandate.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. If there are no further questions, we'll move on to our next order. Thank you, Mr. Ortega. Very well. Okay, the next order of business is number 5, Transmission Expansion Plan Update. Mr. Stills?
Yes, Carl Stills, Interim Deputy Manager of the Energy Department. I've been asked to bring before you a transmission plan. I will tell you we're still in the process of putting this plan together, so I'll give you kind of a high-level overview. And then once we finish the transmission expansion plan, we'll bring the entire plan back to you. But this will get you in the ballpark of where we're at now, what we're thinking, kind of where we're looking to go. If you can see the slide, you'll see that this is a basic schematic of IID's service territory. One of the intertie points, if you'll look to the left side of the slide up there, you'll see the IV sub-collector here, and then our Cal ISO market here. And then in the north, up around our Mirage Devers area, we have another intertie to Cal ISO. You'll see also in the south, we're looking at a CFE tie, and then on the east, on the bottom right-hand corner, we're looking at an eastern tie into Arizona. So when we start looking at this, what we're trying to do is look at a transmission plan that is intertied to multiple markets for the exportation of energy or import of energy if we need to go out on the market and get it. Okay. One of the major projects that went to our board, it originally went to our board in August of 2011, was a major work authorization for our Coachella Valley to Ramon Mirage 230 KV line, commonly referred to as Path 42. Now, you may have heard Path 42. It was triggered by our OATS 1,225 megawatts of generation interconnection in IID's queue and our original transitional cluster study. Since that point in time, the cluster has been slowly decreasing with companies that have not been able to obtain PPAs or sell their energy out to off-takers. There were 11 participants. Current currently in our queue. None of them have PPAs. One of them has signed a participation service agreement and is making milestone payments. And nine of them have paid interconnection. So what we were looking at in the cost of the portion of the Path 42 upgrade we were looking at doing is moving ahead with $25 million out of that upgrade process to put the poles and the cabling in our system from Coachella Valley to Mirage Devers in the La Quinta area. Okay. And the reason we want to do that is Path 42 is currently the most restrictive transmission element for the export of renewable resources to Southern California and elsewhere. And by doing it, we want to increase the transmission import-export capability. Presently, our line is rated for a little over 600 megawatts on the Path 42 area. If we put in a RAS, which we haven't taken to the board, but a RAS scheme going back to the board in a very short period of time. And by a RAS scheme, I'm talking about a remedial action scheme for isolating the line under different types of fault conditions to protect IED system. Then we can get a rating of from 600 to 800 megawatts, and it's about $5 million to implement a RAS. That will be probably some of the cheapest capacity we could possibly buy. This upgrade of the lines and the poles is $25 million. That $25 million will allow us to go from the 800 megawatt capacity up to 1,500 megawatts capacity, so that the line going from here to Mirage Devers for exporting of energy or importing would have a total, instead of 600, of 1,500 megawatts of capacity. That would put us pretty much out in front of the exportation of energy to the Cal ISO or to whatever market we wanted to send it to. One of our customers right now would be the public agencies up in SCAPA, and we're looking at different ways that would trigger further lines going from our Mirage Devers area up into the LA area. But that would be paid for by some of our relationship issues. There's about another $25 to $26 million worth of upgrades that would go along with the Path 42. But those can be put in. The long lead item is doing the poles, doing the wire. The rest of those can go in. As development comes on, we can get those in pretty fast, and we can get a lot of that paid for by the developers. We actually took this back to the board. We felt it was critical. The original justification was to have development pay for it. But because of the issues in the state, because of the exportation, because of the lead time issues, we felt it was prudent for us to go ahead and upgrade that path and to send a message to the state that IID is absolutely going to build transmission. So our board passed that. And that MWA is going forward as we speak.
Mr. Bundy?
Mr. Stills, thank you. Your communication to us that on your transmission build-out, I support it wholeheartedly. Is that being communicated to the state and also the federal level?
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you.
In fact, the minute our board passed this, we got the funding, how we were going to pay for it. We communicated that out to people in the state. Everybody was watching to see what IID was going to do.
The state lobbyists and the federal lobbyists that the IID has are pushing, doing a full court press of this issue?
Yeah, everybody in the state knows we're building Path 42 now.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, the other thing that I wanted to say here, it's not just Path 42. We didn't want to build a bridge to nowhere, because there is a restriction from Mirage Devers into on the west side of Mirage Devers by SCE. This is actually being coordinated with Southern Cal Edison. We're upgrading our side and they're upgrading their side to remove that restriction in that log jam up there. Okay. The project actually consists of upgrading 20.6 miles of towers, foundations. It's a 230 volt circuit, and again, it's located between Coachella and Ramon and Mirage substations. And I've already talked about repaying this. Our schedule, we're looking to have this in service by April of 2014. It's in service now, but have the upgrade in service. And this is a breakdown of our cost in the year that we're looking at them. Again, $25 million broken down over a three-year period, with the largest portion of that being in the 2014 timeframe. The risk that our board were looking at, that if we didn't build it, then developers without PPAs drop out of the cluster. If we did build it and the clusters don't come through, the developers paying for it, we could have had stranded investment. We looked at this as pretty strategic, and that's why we went back and got this. It is strategy to build this out. And so we looked at that risk and said, you know, this is a risk worth taking. And we'll front the money and go from that point. But had we not built it, then IID's ability to build would be questioned by the state and federal agencies. And you know, we've done a lot of lobbying to tell them we're going to build transmission. So this was a litmus test for us to move forward with transmission. And then if we didn't build it, SCE also would have dropped their plans to upgrade their portion, which then if we changed our mind to go back and build it, it would have taken us longer to coordinate that project back through the state and get that project teed back up. And then Assemblyman Perez had a bill for renewable in Imperial Valley that was actually going through at the time, and there was some questions whether that could be supported. Anthony, do you know whether he's picked that back up or not? Okay, so that's been put on hold while we made the decision, and then probably that may move forward next year. And then other entities could possibly build transmission through IID's BA. I don't know if you're familiar with the Desert Renewable Energy Conservation Plan. One of the scenarios had over 9,000 megawatts coming from Imperial Valley, and if you looked at that plan, they're absolutely looking at permitting corridors running all through IID service territory for building a transmission. If we don't build it, somebody else will. Okay, the other thing that we're looking at is how do we proactively promote renewables within the region? Some of those issues are really coming to the forefront in Imperial Valley and Drew substations. And what we're looking at doing is how do we proactively work, and at the same time, how do we build the strongest system, and then how do we maintain IID's integrity in the process? This is a solution that we have proposed to the Cal ISO. If you'll look on this map, you'll see Liebert substation right here with the arrows pointing to it. And right to the south of Liebert, you'll see the west side main canal running along the bottom side of the agricultural portion of the map. And then directly south of that, you'll see Imperial Valley substation here. Off to the west, you'll see the Sea Solar substation. Now, what we're proposing, and we have plans to rebuild a double circuit 230 kV line from Dixieland sub to IV sub, and we have plans to build a double circuit 230 kV line from El Centro switching station to IV sub. The IID presently has about 165 megawatts that we import from the SWPL line, the 500 kV line at IV sub. And so it's important that we maintain the integrity of this right side of this line at IV sub right here, because we presently don't pay Cal ISO fees, even though this is a substation controlled by Cal ISO. We have a transmission service agreement that's grandfathered in here, And if this were to somehow go into and do away with that service agreement or do something to disrupt our grandfathering, it could cost us millions of dollars annually on the energy that we import. To give you a kind of an idea, CalISO for scheduling that through this substation would charge us, just on scheduling charges, about $2 million a year. And then about $11 per megawatt hour for 165 megawatts coming through. That could be as high as $15 million extra a year that we don't presently have. So the integrity of this S line is absolutely critical in this scheme that we're looking at right here. And this keeps IID from being united with the CalISO. Even though we have a demarcation point, an intertie point, we actually own 14.5% of the substation. So that agreement's remaining intact is critical to our overall strategy. The blue portion of that line is what we're proposing. We're proposing to the CalISO that we take one circuit, create switching stations, two 230-volt switching stations, one on one side of the canal and one on the other side of the canal. Now, what's critical here is our board has asked for and is trying to minimize the amount of crossings across the All-American Canal. The Water Department doesn't like the fewer crossings they have, the better. So we're trying to maintain the integrity of one crossing here, which we already have in our S-line. By looking at this solution, this would be an in-line upgrade of that present one crossing. And then by putting a switching station on both sides of that canal, it would make it expandable for renewable on this side of the canal to connect into this switching station, and anything on this side of the canal to connect into this switching station, which then you wouldn't be expanding out a 500 kV substation, and it would be more cost effective to do this. Now, if we do that, what we've put in is for a policy-driven PTO, but this would be a networked activity. And as a networked activity, if we can get it through the CalISO, IID would own this and be able to control the interconnections here. And realistically, on that ownership, we would get a pretty substantial, what they call transmission rate of return, kind of like an IRR. And it would probably be somewhere in the 10 to 12% range, which means that we wouldn't strand this investment. We would get a pretty hefty rate of return that we could then roll over to our own customer base. So if we can get this through, we think that makes sense. It allows us to connect up multiple generators in the area. It really puts IID in the at the forefront of that connection process. And then we'd actually make money on the investment. So that's one of the strategies that we're looking at IV Sub.
We have a question in Lakington.
Okay.
Right. Actually, it's not a question. It would be like if there's any way where you're pointing to something over there and we have like really no way of getting a pointer over here. How in the future can we be looking at the same thing that they're looking at over there? Not to say necessarily that we're lost, because I think we get the general idea, but it's, I think it'd be maybe on a computer, just being able to on your PowerPoint, or
do you have the cursor
to be able to just something for you guys to figure out?
How's
Carl?
That? If she uses the cursor, can you see the cursor?
Hey.
Ah.
You see, you don't get if you don't ask, okay?
Okay.
So, thou shalt not receive.
And I'll try to be more descriptive so she knows where I'm going with this. Okay, the other thing that we're looking at, and down by the Imperial Valley sub, what we wanted to show you is this plat. It has a listing of a number of developers in the region, and you can see from all the different colors on this map that each one of these is a different development. It's basically a solar PV development. There are a number of acres that are here. It's somewhere around the 20,000 acre range, just in the southern portion around the Ivy Sub, which is substantial acreage. The area over here on the very right side of this canal is Clexico. And right over on this side of the canal right here, this is the All-American Canal running here. That's our west side main check. That's approximately 8 miles. You can see there's substantial development in the area. It is pretty intensive, which is going to require a lot from our staff. One of the things that we're looking at here to serve this load, and Mike, this goes to your issue on the parasitic load issue. When we look at parasitic load, a generator is allowed to generate on the line and then run its own, what they call parasitic load or station service load, and then net that out over a monthly basis, and that way they can minimize their cost. But there's an issue between being able to do that in Cal ISO's territory or being able to do that in IID's territory. Now, these generators are on Cal ISO's transmission line, and they'll all be tied into the Ivy Sub area up here at some point. But because they're on the transmission line, they have what they call back feed. They want to be able to not split their load, and they transform down from the line down to a 34.5, down to a distribution type voltage. Well, the problem is when you start transforming it down past a 34.5, you get into the service of distribution, which now is squarely in IID's service territory. We're looking at a solution for charging them, and that's on the back feed issue. So we have our legal staff and staff working on that, on how we actually charge them for the distribution portion of that back feed. The other thing we have is their station service, what they actually use on their air conditioners, their lighting, and stuff like that. Now, Sea Solar down here in the very corner down here used up most of the capacity on our distribution system. Our farming distribution out there was a pretty weak system. But in order for us to serve all of these distribution circuits, we have a plan, and if you'll see right here on this line, this is our PW line that runs between Pruitt Sub and El Centro Switching Station. We're going to have to run 6.2 miles of 92 kV out to a sub-location out here to serve this distribution load for all of these generators out here. And that's going to be quite expensive, and we'll allocate that cost out between all of the solar developers out there, and that's probably around $11 million somewhere. But allocated out, they'll each pay a proportionate share. So when you look at it, that sub is going to be there. That'll be 92 kV, and the reason I brought this up is because I want to look at that sub in a different fashion from a transmission strategy. Because when we start looking at Drew Sub right here, this is a sub that is being put in by LS Power, and our board has approved this substation and this crossing of the West Side Main Canal. But IID has a right to purchase half of that sub in the agreements that they've set up. Now, if we look at how this expansion is going to happen, again, we're looking at something that really serves the area but also puts IID in a large part of the control here. And we're looking at possibly networking that sub into that distribution sub, expanding that out to a 230 kV switching station. And the reason we do that is that, one, it makes the system stronger. But it also gives us the ability, if there is a problem, and the problem would be from Ivy Sub to San Diego on the line, if there's a problem, if that line goes down, then this as a radio feed with all these developers just drops. and it creates a huge problem. Well, to the extent that we can strengthen this and we can strengthen these northern ones that I showed you before by tying them in, networking them to our system, we could do non-firm scheduling back through IID system in both areas to, again, gain wheeling revenue if these lines dropped out here, and it would actually strengthen this whole loop. So our plan would be ultimately to upgrade this to a 92 kV loop, or a 230 kV loop all the way back to El Centro switching station, so that we would have a pretty strong system back and we could schedule and do back this up and then do non-firm scheduling through our system. Okay? So it's just a kind of a strategy that we're working for. This line right here, this network piece, will again have to be approved by the Cal ISO, and but it would give us the ability to tag it into our system, serve the area, get benefits from it, and again put us back in control of the interconnection process. That's pretty much where we're at. The other thing that I'll tell you before we get to these questions is we're looking at this and we're looking at how all of these generators affect our system. So any time a generator ties on a line, if they're identified from a VA as an affected system, they'll identify in their contract that IID is an affected system. If that happens, they have to enter into an agreement with us, and we do an affected system study to go back and look and see what their impacts are to our transmission system. So we're looking at this transmission plan not only from a strategic standpoint. Again, we go back to going east and open up the multiple markets, or going north and then tying into the CFE to the south. We're looking at it from what the strategic portion is. We're looking at it from what IID's own growth is, what we need from our studies to serve our load, and we're looking at it from the strategic, from the affected system study. All of these generators out there, there's about 2,500 megawatts tied into Ivy Sub, that if the Southwest Power Link should fall and go down, all of that current is going to go somewhere. Most of it is going to come through our system. And that means that there would be overloading on certain outlets in our system. Those are identified, and we start looking at who's responsible for that. That goes into upgrading our transmission system because they have to pay for those impacts. Other than that, I'll...
We have a couple questions in La Quinta.
Okay, go ahead.
Member Osborne.
Thank you very much. Regarding the Path 42, do you have a diagram showing how that Path 42 comes through Coachella Valley?
Yeah, hang on. Let me go back.
Is that on your very first one?
Yeah, the very first one here. Again, yes. See this circled system right here? This is our Coachella Valley substation. And our Path 42 upgrade is the upgrade running to Mirage Devers up here. Okay.
All right, I just don't know where La Quinta is on that map.
Actually, this CV sub is right outside, right to the west of Coachella around Avenue 50. If you take Avenue 50 out east towards the small range of mountains out there, Coachella Valley Substation sets right along that range. This line runs right up, crosses 10, and runs pretty much parallel to Mirage Devers, parallel to 10.
Behind Fun City.
Okay. All right, okay. So it doesn't go through La Quinta.
No, it doesn't go through La Quinta. It skirts the edges of it, of
okay.
your...
Now, the last... program we had at our last meeting regarding the geothermal areas on Salton Sea and the potential geothermal expansion down there.
Right.
Will any of these lines feed into that geothermal expansion down in Salton Sea?
Yes. Yes. One of the lines that I didn't mention is, see this circle right in the middle of this schematic right here? You'll see Midway Sub right here. Right now, our board has approved a what we call our Midway to Bannister line, and that goes around the east, southeast portion of the Salton Sea, right around the geothermal, and it tags it into our KNKS line, which runs all the way up to Mirage Evers, and that's really where our Path 42 is, this blue line right here. So this area of transmission here would bring it over to Midway, and then Midway, if it went north, depending on where we intersect with the Cal ISO, it would either go up through Path 42 up to the Cal ISO market, or it would come down through our system to El Centro switching station here and then run out our S line to IV sub and interface there. It just depends on where the point of delivery would be.
All right, so we would have transmission then for that new geothermal. I was told by some of those geothermal folks we wouldn't, but that's what Path 42 is all about, to bring new transmission
to absolutely
some of these
what
developers.
Absolutely what Path 42 is about.
Okay, thank you.
Member Ramirez?
I guess my question would only be that if we can probably get an aerial map maybe on the next meeting to be able to see where these transmission lines are going, because what you guys did in Imperial on showing your transmission line compared to this graph is awkward, especially to, like I said, we understand it, but to give us a clear picture and a clear indication on exactly where these lines are, because I couldn't make sense right now where they pass through. I know where Interstate 10 is, and I know, but I like to see it on an aerial. So if you can provide that for the next meeting, I'd really appreciate it.
Okay.
Because my first question was actually going to be what Mr. Osborne asked in the first place, was where is this path? And actually, like I said, this graph here, although it's you understand it, but I would like to know a lot more about it.
Yeah, there's no reference points on that map to know how it travels through our area.
Sure, I'll be happy to bring something to you and show you where the actual location is. I'll talk about that in the next
meeting. Next meeting will be great. Actually, I want to thank you for your professionalism on this, because you educated. I'm pretty sure I'm speaking for a lot of us here, especially with that cursor there. That was awesome. Thank you.
One of the things that we're trying to do, we've always inherently had a company model for the Energy Department for serving our own load. Well, that model has changed. It's now serving our load, and also how do we work with the renewables to get it out in a strategic format.
Thank you. No further questions here.
Yeah, El Centro, any questions? No questions, Mr. Stills. Thank you. Very, very good presentation. Incredible. Good information. All right, moving on to the next order of business is vegetation management plan update. Mr. Scalera.
Mr. President, thank you, members of the committee. Mario Scalera, interim deputy manager. What we have here is just an update on some of our ongoing efforts to make sure that not only do we meet our state and federal regulatory requirements to keep our vegetation clear from our lines. I think I've mentioned that the last time I gave this presentation, that the number one cause or fine that FERC gives out on for infractions to utilities is actually vegetation management. Of course, that's not something that we've ever been fine for, but it is the number one cause in the industry. What I wanted to do is also show just some examples of what we refer to and what encroaches onto our lines. What you have here is brand new planning of a new subdivision up in the La Quinta area, where the developers with con- as basically put installed palm trees right underneath our transmission line. This is another example on another side. And the other bottom pictures are really just to show you that this doesn't happen just in the cities, but also in the rural areas with particularly palm trees that seem to spring out of nowhere. The proper clearance is essential for us. We expend a little under $3 million with a service agreement with a contractor under the supervision of our internal resources, which has a complement of, I believe, 32 employees, comprising a total of 16 crews. I'm sure you've seen them around town. They're the orange trucks. They do that under our service agreement for us and do our maintenance for them. We have a very extensive outreach program, particularly up in the La Quinta area, which Pat handles for us in trying to educate not just the general public, but also the developers up there, that proper planning, vegetation near IED equipment is essential so that we may keep the reliability and the access of our equipment without any hindrance. We have, as you showed some of the pictures, we have some unmanageable tree growth encroaching on many of our power lines. We have done quite an extensive review the last 3 years where we've reduced the number of outages that have contacted due to contact vegetation by almost 80%. We also ask, and this is anywhere from, again, either our public outreach, our various flyers through the billing, our Facebook page, our web page, our Twitter account, and we ask everybody to please call if you have a question on where to plant your trees, so that means we go out and advise you on where would be the safe, and what kind of plants to put in. I added this, and I apologize. Some of these, this is not included in your format, but I wanted to give you kind of a pictorial view of the kind of clearances that we look at. The one to your left is a typical transmission pole, and it's got what we refer to as underbuilt. This is distribution, and this is kind of the envelope that we look at on this particular type of infrastructure, which is basically we try to keep trees away out of that. There's a distance not only from the pole itself, but once it gets to the conductors, we need to have this clear. Our goal, and I think we're almost there, is to try that when we do our trimming, is that we have a one-year trimming. The idea is to trim back far enough that we don't have to be back for another year before this particular tree would then get inferred into our envelope here. The one to your right is just strictly a distribution line. The distances are a little smaller, but it's still the same principle. The idea is to have a one-year trimming cycle, trim far enough back so that when the crews get back, they have a 4 year to get back. This becomes a little challenge for you, as you might be aware, as most trees have a different growing rate. So we track not only the specific location of our lines, but the type of trees, where they're located, and their growth rate. We've computerized this to some extent, and this again has helped us to be able to, again, we're about 80% there, so that hopefully in the next coming year we'll have it down to just one control cycle. This is, and the reason that this was not necessarily duplicated from the previous slide, but this is what we, typical of what we provide to our customers. This should have been one of the many flyers that was inserted into their billing. And it gives a very descriptive explanation of where and how we would like for you to clear, and why it seems sometimes when our crews go out there and they seem to over-trim. The over-trimming, again, is due to the fact that we want to be able to last the clearing cycle for a year till we get back and clear again. Now, this is, in the next couple of slides, are traditionally more to La Quinta, since most of our La Quinta is underground. But again, this is going back to what guys call them cycle busters, but they're really fast-growing trees that tend to have a cycle faster than most other trees than others. palm trees being one of them. They grow very fast, very rapidly, and they tend to get very tall. We're going into the growing season now. We've noticed now the trees, hopefully the temperature will get cooler. They've started to grow a little bit quicker. Pad mounts. You see them in a lot of the new subdivisions. We have a lot of this up in the La Quinta area. This is an ongoing problem from an encroachment. One wouldn't think, heck, everything's underground. There shouldn't be a problem. But what happens is the homeowners don't like our green boxes. I personally think they're pretty good looking box, but most owners don't. So they tend to want to hide them. And what typically happens, we ask that there at least be clearance around them of 3 foot with a 10-foot clearance to where the door is. This is mostly, believe it or not, they do need to have some air so that they do cool. It is a transformer, so it needs air to circulate through it. And then, of course, you need the 10-foot, and this is really more for the safety of our personnel when they have to get inside the box itself. Did I go back? Let me print this.
We have a question in La Quinta.
Pardon me?
Question. So all of these are communicated to the city of La Quinta and other cities in this area, so they're well aware of it. For developers that come to our area, they're aware of these
exactly. Standards? We have meetings Good. With the cities, the planning and building departments. We meet at least Great. Twice a week okay. and try to relate that kind of message to them. And then we have outreaches.
But I think
Thank you. Okay.
Mario, but I think what's more important is that we ask the cities to adopt these as landscape standards so that they become the norm whenever landscape plans are presented for approval, rather than to just do it on a project-by-project basis or to talk about it. If the cities could adopt them as standards, it would
help.
Yeah,
that's what I want to make sure, that these are adopted so it's automatic, so to speak, when they come to the city. Okay. Thank you.
We have one more question,
Yes,
Mr. Blum.
Mario, I'm thinking of Adams Avenue. My house backs to Adams, and I'm wondering from the setbacks that you have here are not realistic for Adams, and I'm curious. I see a lot of trees growing into the power lines, and I'm wondering, do you have the authority to go into like a CC&R area and trim those for the power lines, or is that something that you have to coordinate with the? I guess, is there a state law or any kind of a law that permits you to go in and trim those to protect the power lines?
There is state statute that allows us to go in and trim the trees. It's called Geo 95. We're also a PUC, even though we may not necessarily be under their preview, we follow all their rules, which allows the utilities to go in and properly maintain the facilities. Now, what we do is that if we find a particular tree or bush that's infringing, we contact the homeowner. Or in some cases, it's actually been a developer. We had a case in La Quinta just recently where a developer was planting palm trees right underneath the tree. We were able to work with him, and he relocated them before they were finished planting them. We have a whole procedure so that if the offending tree is either has to be trimmed, we check with the owner to make sure that he is aware of what we're trying to do. If we can, we actually try to get him to allow us to remove the tree. We have a tree vegetation replacement program. If we can get the customer to agree to removing a tree that is growing into our power lines, we'll actually go in and replace that tree with a much slower growing tree, a tree that will not gain a height that'll eventually get underneath our line. Because we do understand that a lot of these trees have been there for very long. The residents and the customers have, there's a reason that tree's there, so we don't just go in there and try to butcher it. To answer your question, yes, we do. but we don't necessarily go there with that necessarily in hand. We try to work with the customers and try to come to a reasonable accommodation.
Thank you.
What will happen is, and I want to get back because I get disturbed when you tell me that we've got a bunch of trees and a bunch of lines up and up there. Mm-hmm. What happens a lot of times is that a lot of our distribution poles and mostly distribution poles have cable and TV and fiber underneath, and those are the low hanging wires that you see much lower than these poles here. And those aren't regulated, have the same restrictions for vegetation and such. So what happens is they have a tendency to get grown into with much, and they may get in there before they're into our wires. But I'm going to remember that. I'm going to talk to the supervisor up there to make sure that the reports I'm getting are accurate.
Mario?
Yes.
Steve Bayard here. Is there a JPA for a joint pole authority, I'm going to call it, for our distribution lines with the cables and other companies?
What we have is what we refer to as contracts for attachments or contact per poles. They must apply for an application to hang off our pole. There is an annual fee, or actually it's a monthly fee, but we do it annually for attachments, whether it's a telephone, cable, whatever it may be. There's some restrictions on how close they can get to our lines. There's restrictions on how many attachments we can have on a pole. But it's state regulated. In fact, the federal government about 2 years ago mandated that all utilities give access, particular to the telephone companies, which are the providers of the internet. But under that same statute, it allowed us to reassess our contact fees. We generate roughly, I believe, $480,000 a year off of these contacts, what we refer to as contacts. The poles belong to us. We have roughly about 120,000 poles, I believe, out there, and so many of them have contacts on them.
I have a question, Mark.
Sure.
For the homeowner who wants to plant trees or vegetation or on their property or near, does the online system provide you recommendations on what you can plant or what you should not plant, or any of these diagrams available online?
The first diagram, the color diagram, Mr. Nunez, that was up, President Nunez was before does, you know, we don't have particular type of trees, and that's probably something that we should. We've been collecting a library of that, and you know what, I'm going to bring that up to, maybe it's time for us to put it there, right. and the type of trees they could. Have we added that? Okay, we do. I knew that we were working on it.
Good to know.
If I may, I just want to go back to the very last slide, because I do want to make everybody aware is that there is a number of different types of boxes you see out here. This is what we refer to as a switch. They tend to be the taller one. This is what you see everybody. I've got one of these in front of my house, but mine's not covered. It is a little bit greener than this one. And then these are underground vaults. We don't have very many, but they are important. Particularly in the areas, what happens if they're covered such as this or right here or even this one, in a case of an event, believe it or not, our crews have a tendency to miss them because they're not very big and they'll drive right by them. Unfortunately, we don't have the ability to put something out on the street like your hydrants have to say across the street. So it is important. Part of the clearance is for our ability to get there. They are metal. They tend to corrode if they're irrigated, and that's probably the biggest expense we have on some of these boxes is the fact that sprinkler systems get on them. They start to rust. They get water in our lines, and that doesn't help our cable. But I will say that particularly up in La Quinta and the few associations we have down here. They've been very helpful. We've got a very active program up in the La Quinta area with a lot of the gated communities that have been, and they've been very forthcoming and allow us to go in there and not only educate their folks to take care of their lawns, but in trying to get them to clear some of the vegetation out. And again, that's just a really quick update that I wanted to give the committee on our vegetation program, because it is a growing concern, particularly now that growing season and planting season is ahead of us.
We have a question in La Quinta.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, Mr. Scalera, Gilbert Ramirez, City Coachella. You know, I'm sure that you're well aware of the situation we have with a tremendous amount of seniors, large trees right on your transmission lines. I'm sure you guys spent a pretty penny in my city on the subcontracting that you guys provide. The problem is that I've been on the council almost 20 years, and I'm apologetic on what the real process is on who do we call. You know, I've been asked by a few seniors that they're having problems with, you know, their trees up against the poles. Do we call you? Do we call the subcontractor, or, you know, who's the first point there?
Well, I could give you my number, but I would I'll suggest that if you call our 800 number, our call center, it's our information center. They're equipped to address any question, whether it be from an outage in your own home to a street light out, to a vegetation question, to any question that you might have about the Imperial Irrigation District. It's 24/7, so it doesn't matter what time they call. They're very good about forwarding that information to the proper section within our company. And then what we would do is, once it gets forwarded, then we would contact that customer that's made that request. So if my first suggestion would be is that just have them call the 800 number, and they'll take care of it from there.
That would be me, because I want to know.
Yeah.
But my second question would be is that... why is it that they only trim them, and if they're a nuisance, why aren't they ever taken down? I think that like I said, Coachella and some of the areas in Cochalita that was established in 1942, you could imagine, you know, some of the issues that are in that particular area of Coachella. I mean, it's the oldest, and I think that's where the majority of the problems are. And I think as a council member, whether I'm, like I said, there or not, and after November, it doesn't make any difference. It's something that needs to be addressed, is by being able to go out there and telling these people that they're going to remove the tree or to figure out some type of other alternative than just the trimming. Because I see your subcontractor retrimming every 2 to 3 years trees that should, in my opinion, should be taken out. You know, because of the fact that it's going to be a problem 2-3 years down the road, and they come back out and I'm not asking for a change on how you do business that way, but I need to be a little bit more educated in that area, so that when I need to know the right answer there. So,
well,
that,
in fact,
a subcontractor problem, whether it's a subcontractor problem, or is it, you know, working with IID and coming up with a better solution for that?
Well, to address this, it actually was a difference in problem. One of the things that we had a tendency to do, the program was designed as a trimming program, just trimming back. Like any utility, we've gone through and we've looked at a number of issues. Where can we reduce the costs and gain a little bit more product from it? And so what we had done is exactly what you have suggested. Is I went back and I looked at it and I asked the very same question: why do we keep trimming? You know, why are we not removing problem trees? So for the past year, we've had a very aggressive tree removal program, where if we identify a tree that we can remove that we think the customer will allow us to remove, we make contact with the customer, the utility, the city, whoever it may be, and ask for permission to remove it. We've probably removed more trees in the last 9 months than we've removed in the last 9 years for that very same thought. Having said that, trees have attended, you know, they're very special to people. And even though you have some very tall or very old trees, people grow attached to them, and we have to try to work with them because they don't want them removed. If it was up to our crews, we'd go through and remove every tree that's in our line. But we have to be cognizant that we are a member of the community, so we try to work with those people and not remove them. Well, if we have to remove them, plant something else, or try to find.
I like that.
You know, and that's what we found is when we first tried to just remove them, people, you know, were taken aback. They weren't, you know, they didn't like that. So we implemented about 5 months ago a tree replacement, and it's worked really well. We removed some trees under Calexico for the city of Calexico that are underneath our line. We went back and replaced some trees. We're working with the city of Brawley right now. They've got some very tall palm trees that have been here for a long time, and we're trying to find an equitable solution with them on how to address those. So we are exactly doing what you're stating. Is we've come to the same conclusion. I've come to the same conclusion. I put that to them and says, you know, why do we keep going back and just trimming the damn things?
I appreciate that so much, and I do apologize that if we didn't really have the representation prior to the 9 months. And like I said, it's something that I appreciate hearing that answer. So thank you, Mr. Escalera.
Yeah, more than welcome. If you ever need anything from me, just contact Mary, and I'd be more than glad to forward some information to you. And I make that to offer to any of the members.
Yeah, and I'm sure La Quinta has the same problem over there, you know, especially in the Cove over there. So thank you, Mr. Lear, again. Gracias.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any further questions? None from El Centro? Any further questions from...
None in La Quinta.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Yeah. Lear. Very good. Okay. Moving on to item number 7, appointment of a subcommittee member. Please allow me to present Esther Gomez as a newly appointed budget subcommittee member. As soon as we can coordinate our times and such, we will be meeting. I was the last member that was appointed by our previous chairperson, and I had to step down because of my position as the chair. So I kind of automatically just, as a chairperson, am on the committee. So my position needed to be replaced. Therefore, Ms. Gomez will be appointed as the new member. So, thank you, Mrs. And she has accepted, correct? Thank you. Okay, moving on to item number 8, coordinator's report. Marion?
Yes, thank you. My name is Marion Champion. I'm the ECAC coordinator. I have two items that I wanted to bring to the ECAC's attention. First is we do have the California Energy Summit happening next week on Thursday and Friday next week in Palm Springs, at the Palm Springs Convention Center. I did send out an email to all the members.
This week.
I'm sorry, this week. I apologize. This 4th and 5th, this week. And I did send out an email to all the members asking for anyone who'd like to participate. I do have two people who have replied, Mr. McFadden and Ms. Soleil. If any other members are interested, please get in contact with me either by calling me or sending me an email by tomorrow morning. We need to go ahead and fill all of our seats and make sure that we have the room for everyone. Second, I have been reaching out to several of the members to see if there was a way we could change the November 19th meeting. I know, Mr. Abadi, you had some concern with pushing it to the 19th. Unfortunately, any other night of the week besides a Monday night, I'm having a lot of scheduling conflicts with city council meetings and other meetings. So it looks like our meeting will have to stand as November 19th for our next meeting. Those are my only two updates for you.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Moving on to item number 9, department update. Mr. Scaletta.
Thank you, Mr. President. Real quickly, if I may, I do want to, again, make our members aware that copper theft is still an issue. To please, particularly those of you that have influences within the cities, to please remind the your police department that to keep a vigilant eye and on our facilities. The average theft yields about $20 worth of copper and causes about $67,000 worth of damage to us. So it's a no-win situation for anybody. But on that same note, I wanted to, and I apologize if I've mentioned this to you before, but we're very proud of this. About 2 or 3 weeks ago, so I couldn't have told you, we actually had an off-duty troubleshooter up in the La Quinta area spot two individuals that were stealing copper. They were actually in a vault very similar to that underground. Whoops. Marion, you ready? Very similar to this one, who had lifted the vault up, and they were actually inside cutting the copper groundings to there. He spotted them while he was doing. Luckily, he happened to have his radio with him, his phone, I should say, called the dispatch, and between him and the uncalled troubleshooter up, we're able to chase down the two individuals, and they actually caught him. We've arrested them. We're pressing charges. We're stressing to our own employees that it's important. We've reminded them that probably chasing them down is probably not the best idea, but at the same time, we're very proud of their proactive approach to their facilities. We wish that it is a problem, so if you do see any suspicious activity in our substations or even just a box such as this, you know, do call the 800 number, and we do have a reward program. We're kind of updating it because it is quite a problem to all of us. Most of the time, if you're in the city and you'll see two or three city lights that are out, it's not because the bulbs are burnt. It's because somebody's gone in there and stole the wire. So it is a problem, and we ask for your assistance in that. Yes, sir.
You guys worked really close with some the local recycle agencies.
We have our own investigators have very good relationships, not only with the recycling, with the local sheriffs. In fact, they've established contacts with not just the Border Patrol, but actually with some of the border agents on the other side, because believe it or not, copper theft is a problem down there too. And so unfortunately, they can't be everywhere, and so we're asking the public to help us out on that, because eventually that cost is rolled back into the cost of providing the service to all our customers. And that's all I have, Director Nunez.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Questions? No? Okay. Mr. Stills.
Yes, thank you. I think all of you are aware of the September 8th, 2011 outage that blacked out most of California and regions around California. Since that time, my ID has taken a very proactive stance in what we do to our system to look to prevent that type of outage. We moved a 300 MVA transformer up to Coachella Valley Substation, where we had two 150s. We paralleled them, making that effectively a 300 MVA, and set another 300 MVA transformer up there to give us double the capacity we had that would flow through there. We took our relay settings, even though they were set to IEEE standards for extreme temperature areas. They were set at 120%. We went with a recommended 150%. We looked at that, determined that we could protect our system under the extreme temperatures. We've been moving our relay settings up to 150% of the capacity for the thermal overload. We've taken our alarms at the SOC and we've put audible alarms on there, so now if something goes wrong, we have somebody that it audibles and it actually responds to them. And then we've been looking at the region and regional planning and sharing real-time data, setting projects in place to share that data. Well, I'm actually happy to tell you that a year and 17 days to the date, the Imperial Valley to North Gila line relayed again on September 25th. An IID system held, and no further outage was experienced. In fact, we actually kept that coast from going further into the black with the outage and everything. So our system and the changes that we're making is really a very positive thing for the region. Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Stills. Thank you. Any questions? No? Thank you very much. Okay, and go ahead. We have one. Go ahead.
I apologize. I forgot.
Yeah.
I want to remind everybody that October is Energy Awareness Month.
Good.
Which means that the IID will have, you know, periodic updates on our webpage on some of the folks that actually deliver your power, and then we're also going to have information on how to save power and history on the power industry. But again, October is Energy Awareness Month.
Okay. You guys are doing any, and there's a lot of agencies, local agencies that have local health fairs and things of that nature throughout the valley. Are you guys planning anything?
Well, we were planning to have an Oktoberfest, but we couldn't get that past the general manager. No, but we'll have something in our local division offices to celebrating that month.
Okay, thank you. Bring your beer. Okay, moving on to members' comments. We'll start, I guess, to my left here. Michael?
Mario, I have a couple bucks. We can have our October's best out here in the parking lot.
Did that last?
Well, I've got a whole list of where they're being held in San Diego. If you want to join me.
Thank you.
Mr. McFadden.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to ask if we could discuss a public benefit for our agenda. If we could have it on the agenda for discussion.
Public benefits?
Yes.
Sure, I'd be glad to.
I'd be interested in what's happening with that or what the plan is from staff, because we've been kind of sitting on that for about a year or so.
All right.
I'm just curious. The next issue is, I talked about a long time ago, and I want to follow up on this thing about, is IID going to ask for the ratepayers for a rate increase? And if they are, I'd like to have a discussion on that, you know. And I talked about this a long time ago, and I'm just following up on these items because I have not seen no activity on these items. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McFadden. Mr. Boddy.
Yes, I'm also on the next agenda. We've been told we were going to get updates, but we missed them. The total cost of indirect or liquidated damages of the outage of or failure of Unit 3. If that could be on the next agenda.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Boddy. La Quinta.
Thank you, Ms. Soleil.
Yes, I was just wondering if we could get a schedule of when these committee meetings are televised. Last year we were given the information that they were going to be televised. If they are being televised, when and what time and where can people look at them?
Channel 17, Monday nights after the board meeting.
Is that when they're on? I have looked and looked. I've never found them even, you know, a schedule of, I mean, if we could just get an emailed schedule, that would be great. They may not be available in Thousand Palms. So that could be. We have Time Warner, but sometimes they don't show things in our area that they do other places. So
okay.
It's a black app for Thousand Palms.
Okay, we'll get that information from Marion. Councilmember Osborne? Ms. Kay? Mr. Bayard? Ms. Abrott?
Well, if I can get my mic on. As far as I know, the events that might be interesting at least to the members up here in the Coachella Valley, is that on the third Wednesday of this month, on the 17th, there's going to be an East Valley Vote Tech Night, which the Imperial Irrigation District traditionally helps with. It's a very good opportunity for the students and the parents from this part of the valley to come to the fairgrounds in Indio and see what is available for, in both colleges and the vocational education in this area. We have people from out of state that come as well. Last year there were about, I think it's the numbers, 2,500 people. There's pretty amazing. So anybody that has extra time that evening, it starts at 6 and ends about 8:30. It's amazing and wonderful to see that many people interested in what's going to happen with their children.
Where?
The Indio Fairgrounds at the Fullenweider Building. Okay. And once you get around the fairgrounds, you'll see all the parking, and you go, oh, yeah, that's where it is. So thank you once more for IID reaching out to the community and helping. Appreciate your involvement. Thank you.
Mr. McNicky?
Nothing.
Thank you, Councilmember Ramirez.
Just wanted to thank staff. You guys are doing a wonderful job. Thank you.
And I just want to remind everyone, we do have that Southern California Energy Summit. I'll be there, and I look forward to seeing everyone else there. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Ortega, Mr. Stills, and Mr. Escalera on those wonderful presentations. Appreciate that. Next meeting is scheduled for November 19th at 6 p.m. Yep. There being no further business, meeting is adjourned.